Right, so, Antony, here we are again. Let's carry on this list of adjectives. So we've got adjectives going from J to, I mean, you know, I wanted to do like an A to Z, but some of those letters, it's hard to find adjectives for them, like X and Z as well.
I wonder if John Lennon was X-ray phobic when he went to the airport. They probably didn't have those machines at the airport, so yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, I think the Z ones are looking good, actually, looking at the Google Doc here, anyway.
Yeah, we've got a couple of good Z ones in there, we'll come on to those in due course. Right, so let's keep this snappy if we can.
Okay.
And we're going to start with the word jealous, which is quite an appropriate one for John because he did write that famous song, Jealous Guy.
Yeah.
Was he a jealous guy, do you think?
I think this is one of the things he was quite upfront about, yes. He was unlike a lot of celebrities in that a lot of them tried to hide the dark stuff. And he almost went the opposite way. He almost played up the dark stuff a bit too much. I think we mentioned primal therapy before, and I think that was part of that. It was good for him to get out all the demons. So I'm sure he was jealous. I think he was quite jealous of Paul McCartney, but then that's another touchy subject. But yeah, in a word, yes. And he did write a song about it, as you said. So I would say yes.
Yeah, I guess in relationships, his first wife, Cynthia, there were, some moments when, for example, she was dancing with other people and he flew off the handle or reacted really badly. We won't go into the details of, you know, the fights that they had and stuff, but I think she described him as being a jealous person. So, yeah, there he is. He was a jealous guy.
There's a link with Insecure, of course, which I think we've already talked about. Definitely.
Okay, the next J word is jittery, which is unlike jealous, which I think most people will know, jittery is an adjective that people might not have heard before. So what does jittery mean?
Jittery is perhaps when you're a bit on edge, nervous, that kind of thing.
Feeling nervous, behaving nervously. And if someone's jittery, it sort of manifests itself in certain bits of physical behavior. Like a jittery person might be quite jumpy. They might be easily surprised by noises or, what's that? Or fiddling and fidgeting with their fingers because they're feeling uncomfortable or nervous.
Yeah, and to have the jitters, I guess, is to be nervous. Maybe when you're about to go on stage, I mean, that would be a very good example, wouldn't it? John Lennon did have these almost like spasmodic movements. He was a bit like that, yeah, so I'd go along. And again, I don't want to keep going about drugs, but you have to factor that in, let's be honest. That's going to add to that a little bit.
I've heard you on your podcast talking about the later years of John Lennon when, according to the official story, he was living in domestic bliss and all that stuff. But you spoke to one of John's son's childhood friends other people who knew him at the time. Like, it's amazing that you've spoken to these people who have directly knew him and spent time with him. And I think some of those people described him as being quite a nervous and jittery character.
Yeah, well, Caitlin, who is the lady who's Sean Lennon's playmate. Yeah, she said he had tons of energy. And I said, would you say a lot of it was nervous? And she said, definitely. It's that thing, I've just done a podcast about emotional intelligence. We were talking about how people who have a high stress level, one of their justifications is that it gives them energy. And it probably is true. You know, if you run on stress, you do have high levels of energy, but then unfortunately you get the crash at some point. You know, the party can't last forever. But yes, I think a lot of nervous energy.
I feel jittery if I drink too much coffee. I mean, we use coffee as an example of a drug. In the morning, I might, you know, if I feel I want to, I might have like a nice large coffee, and you get the high of being up on the caffeine where you're able to focus and you get energy and it feels good. And then after a couple of hours, if I've got an empty stomach, I'll start to feel a bit jittery and uncomfortable and not very happy.
Yeah.
I think John drank a lot of coffee as well.
Oh, I think, yeah, definitely in the later years, yeah, coffee and cigarettes. He used to smoke these really, really strong called Gitane, these French cigarettes, which apparently it's almost like inhaling a cigar smoke. They're that strong.
Oh, my God. He was tough.
Yeah. People always ask me, what would he have done? And I always say, well, I'd like to think he would have lived to 80, but, you know, I'm skeptical.
Okay, the next word on the list is knackered, which is one of those kind of British slang words. I don't think they use it in America, but knackered just means exhausted, like really tired. Do you reckon there were times when he was completely exhausted, probably short term, but also in terms of artistically, do you think he was ever burnt out?
That's something I've talked about on the show. Again, talking about what he may have done had he been around longer. I'm not sure his musical palette, perhaps in terms of chords and melodies, was certainly not as wide as Paul's. And yeah, there definitely were times. I mean, one of the myths that's been well smashed is that in the 5 years, 75 to 80, he wasn't making any music. He was making music a lot, but he was combining songs, which he did quite a lot. He'd write a bit of a song and then he'd often combine it with another bit of a song. But when I think of Knackered, I mean, thanks to Mr. Lewison, Mark Lewison, and books like The Complete Beatles Chronicle, we know just how much they worked. And yes, I mean, these tours, you could feel knackered just reading about them. You don't have to even go on them. You know, if you think about it, the treadmill of touring, I mean, the Beatles on the 64 tour, just to give an example, I don't remember the exact numbers, but it's something like 30-odd cities in 30-odd days. People used to say, oh, it must be great to see all these places. And they're like, we don't see anywhere. You know, we just see hotel rooms and concert halls. Yeah, and Cynthia in her book said that when he'd come home, he would sleep for 3 days, you know. So I think emotionally knackered as well.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't done a big tour with a band. I've only done little tours, either with bands or as a comedian. I mean, I've done festivals and stuff as a comedian and other things. And just touring, traveling, and then the nerves of performing, the energy that you need during the performance, all of the craziness afterwards and stuff. Just like 3 or 4 days of that over a weekend festival, yeah, or over a 5-day comedy festival or something. It's exhausting. I remember just doing like the Brighton Fringe Festival, and after 5 days being completely knackered, coming home on the train and just like falling asleep on the train and stuff.
Yeah.
But 30 cities, this is in America, I guess, yeah, in 30 America. Days. And then all that driving, you know, being in the back of the van the whole time.
All the press as well. And they were even writing songs on tour. I mean, it was just incredible. I think George Martin called it, is it a 2-ring or a 3-ring circus? I've forgotten.
One of those
two. It never let up. Like a traveling circus almost. You just came from place to place continuously. And it's like, oh, can we have a day off? And like, no, you've got to meet the president of the Philippines. You probably know that story, right?
Oh, yeah, there's that.
No, I want to stay in bed.
Yeah, the one time when they basically said no, when they went to the Philippines, I mean, we can't tell the whole story, but essentially there was a bit of a misunderstanding. Imelda Marcos of the Philippines thought that she was going to meet the Beatles, or that they were coming to meet her, and it was a big event. And they didn't turn up because they were still in bed. They refused to come because they hadn't been told about it. And it was a huge scandal in the Philippines, and they basically had to leave in a big hurry. Must have been scary. Essentially, like the whole country turned against them as a result of this, because basically Imelda Marcos, she lost a lot of face. She was embarrassed in front of all her people. So the media went into overdrive against them and they had to get out really quickly. I think they were scared they would be killed or something.
I think they were in fear of their lives. And just off mic before we started recording, we were talking about the power of the media. When they go after someone, you know, the corporate media, they can turn millions against you. Yeah, John and one of the roadies famously hid behind some nuns when they were being pursued by all kinds of people in the streets trying to get to their plane. So, yeah, very, very tough. But the Beatles are fed up of having to meet all these dignitaries. A good expression is the eye of the hurricane, because apparently a hurricane is very calm right in the middle. So when they were in their hotel rooms, when it was just the four of them and maybe a couple of Liverpool friends, they could be calm. But as soon as they went out the door, then they're just in this madness.
Hotels surrounded by fans screaming their names, fans trying to get into the hotel, trying to smuggle themselves into the hotel in suitcases, in boxes, trying to climb up
drain pipes, fire escapes,
trying to get in. Just absolute madness.
Well, she came in through the bathroom window from Abbey Road is apparently about that. Again, maybe about something else as well, but that's one of the stories. There's lots of stories regarding some of the songs. Some young lady climbed up or something and tried to get in through the bathroom window to their hotel. They would write songs about anything. It was great.
Absolutely. That was really good. Oh, yeah, I suppose if you just sort of go to the bathroom, if you're Paul, I'm just going to go to the bathroom and there's a girl in the bathroom. It would be pretty weird to discover this girl and to maybe talk to her. And if she was starstruck, it would be a strange little human interaction with this person who was maybe unable to talk to you.
If you want a great film about the problems of fame, Woody Allen's Stardust Memories. Fantastic film. Because I won't go into it now because we've got to get on. But the camera is from his perspective. He plays a famous guy, almost playing himself. The camera view is his view, and it's just people coming at him the whole time. Oh, will you read my script? Oh, I love your film. Will you do this? Will you do that? And then he comes in the hotel room, and there's a young lady in there. And you kind of think he's going to take advantage of that. But he's actually like, he's completely knackered, in fact, after a whole day of doing press. And he's like, what are you doing in there? What are you doing? It's just that madness. You really, people's innate madness comes out with famous people. They just lose their head. There's another expression.
Did we say before about the George Harrison quote, which is like, you know, the world went mad and they blamed it on us.
Yeah. Well, they gave their screams and we gave our nervous systems.
Yeah. Talking about some of these adjectives to describe John Lennon, some of them seem to be quite negative. You know, we've got like jealous, jittery, and some of the other ones we had before, like bad-tempered and abrasive and stuff like that. I just wanted to kind of maybe repeat the sentiment that a lot of these words seem a bit negative, but overall, I don't view Lennon's life in a negative way. And I think his influence on the world, and certainly on my life as a Beatles fan, has been broadly positive. And maybe we should focus on some of the nicer sides of his personality. The next word is kind-hearted.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, there's plenty of evidence. So Albert Goldman, who wrote this very negative book, in one of the interviews, he said, oh, John Lennon wasn't generous at all, and he wasn't loving either. And Caitlin, this lady who was Sean's playmate, she said, oh, that's absolutely not true. And there's lots of evidence. There is lots of dark stuff with John Lennon, but I think he was genuinely generous. Ringo Starr says something like, he'd give you his heart or something like that, you know?
Yeah.
If he liked you, he'd give you everything kind of thing. So I think he was kind-hearted, yeah.
And we talked before about that story of the fan who travelled so far to talk to him, and he let him into his home and gave him some lunch and stuff.
That's right, yeah.
Another positive adjective is the word lovable. What can we say about the word lovable? What have some of his friends, or maybe his friends from the Liverpool days, said about him?
Yeah, that's the thing. With John Lennon, if I had to give one adjective to describe John Lennon, multifaceted is it. So what we're talking about really is different sides of this guy. And I think his friends in Liverpool would probably say that he was, you know, he was very cutting and all the other things we've said. But then you would get this other side that would almost rescue it. You know, if they suddenly decided, oh, that John Lennon's a bit rough, then he'd just do something that was so nice. And I don't know if I'd have any specific examples. It was just a general personality trait. I mean, there are testimony from fans, for example, some young lady fans who he just had a totally platonic relationship with. And often if they were younger than him, he had a nurturing side as well, which apparently came out. He wanted to pass on his wisdom to younger people. So that's one thing, quite a lovable trait, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you just watch, like, one of my favorite films is A Hard Day's Night, and it's obviously scripted and stuff, but I think it captures something of their spirit. And they all have their own little scenes, I guess, except Paul's one was cut out. But they all have their own little scenes. And the one with John is that he ends up talking to this woman in the stairs, and they have like this odd conversation where they seem to be talking at cross purposes.
Yeah.
She's talking about a person, and he doesn't know what she's talking about, but he carries on the conversation anyway. Yeah. It's a bit odd. But that, it just, something quite sweet in him in that scene. He's just so sweet and lovable. He's not being mean or nasty or anything, as he often wasn't. He wasn't like that all the time. The way he talks to her and interacts with her, and I don't know, he just has a very approachable, vulnerable charisma to him.
Hello.
Hello.
Oh, wait a minute.
No, I'm not.
Oh, you are.
I'm not.
Oh, you are. I know you are.
I'm not, no.
You look just like him.
Do I? You're the first one that said that ever.
Yes, you do, look.
No, my eyes are lighter. All right, buddy.
Oh, my nose. Yes, your nose is very.
Is it?
Well, I would have said so.
Oh, you know him better, though.
I do not. He's only a casual acquaintance.
That's what you say.
What have you heard?
It's all over the place.
Is it? Is it really?
Mm, but I wouldn't have it. I stuck up for you.
I knew I could rely on you.
Thanks.
You don't look like him at all.
She looks more like him than I do.
Yeah, and I think you can only fake that up to a point. I think the truth comes out in the end. My favourite line in Hard Day's Night, actually, this is one that was a John Lennon line that they incorporated, when the grandfather says, oh, I thought I was going to have a change of scenery. All I've had is a room and a car and a plane and a car and a car and a car. Or a room in a room, or something like that. And it was famously, a journalist said to John Lennon, they'd just been somewhere, they said, oh, how did you like it? And he said, well, it was a room in a car, and a plane in a car, and a room in a car. Brilliant line. Brilliant line.
Yeah.
You know, rather than saying, oh, it was great, we had a great time, he just told the truth. We did bugger all. We just got shunted from one place to another.
Yeah. And a certain kind of poetry oddly and just like repeating all the a room in a car and a plane in a car and a car and a car.
Definitely. Yeah. And that comes out in the lyrics, as we'll see later.
Yeah. Okay. We've got misunderstood. You've said multifaceted, which is a nice, definitely a nice phrase, meaning having various sides to it, various aspects, multifaceted. Misunderstood. I mean, I think we don't need to go into that. Narcissistic is one, which is, okay, we're back to the negative adjectives again. Narcissistic is the adjective. Narcissism is the noun. A person would be a narcissist. It's really not a nice word.
Yeah, famously comes from the god Narcissus, who saw his reflection in a puddle and fell in love with himself. That's where it comes from. I really wanted to make the point. I'm very uncomfortable with people diagnosing. Donald Trump is obviously a great example. Again, the media has decided he's a narcissist. And fine, he's probably got a lot of those tendencies. But I've had a therapist on Glass Onion show, maybe I mentioned it earlier, and he was very uncomfortable with the public diagnosing people, let's say. But the point I really wanted to make is not that John Lennon was necessarily narcissistic, but that fame, I think maybe we talked about this earlier, it's almost built in that you become somewhat narcissistic. Because try and imagine, you know, I've never had this, but try and imagine people just telling you you're amazing just sort of all day, every day, then having a go at you when you turn out not to be as amazing as they thought, you know?
Yeah.
When you get that level of fame.
Yeah, it's going to go to your head.
That's it.
It's almost no way of avoiding it if people are building you up and up and up constantly all the time, especially when you see the world and the reaction that you've had on the world, you know, the effect or impact you've had on the world. When you see that, it's going to be hard not to start believing your own hype, to start believing that you are special in some way. But what, I don't know, are there any narcissistic episodes or examples that we can give?
I'm not really sure, actually. I don't think John Lennon won on the level of famous people. I don't think he was high on the scale of narcissism. Some may disagree. I think what the Beatles had in their favor, and we talked about this when we did a show about Elvis, there were four of them. You know, Elvis had the whole thing and they had a quarter of it each. And also they had this down-to-earth Liverpool thing where they would send it up. If anyone got too big for their boots, they would send them up. So I'm not actually that sure. Well, I'll give you one example. Okay, the Naked album cover we talked about before. The fact that you want to bare your body, your naked body, to the world. I totally get it. It was the two virgins idea, is the idea that he felt like when he met Yoko, it was almost like he'd gone back to the beginning. And this was his first love. You know, he famously said in the song, "I'm in love for the first time." Imagine Cynthia listening to that, his first wife. Must have been pretty hurt. Yeah. But he's expressing a sentiment where he's almost like he's resetting. You know, all that other stuff was training. And then this is my real life with Yoko. But I think you could say it's quite narcissistic to put your naked body on an album cover.
Look, everybody, here I am. Look at me.
Yeah, look at me, exactly. But I don't think there's huge traits of it. I think it was one part of it, but a lot of it was because he was so famous. It's a byproduct, let's say.
Yeah, I would agree. And it's not like he had nothing to back it up, because like the worst aspects of narcissism is when it's empty. It's just someone loving themselves, but they don't actually have anything to offer to the world.
Yeah.
You know, and they're only interested in themselves and convincing others of how great they are. But John didn't need to do that. Everyone else was doing that for him. There was actual substance to the guy. And so maybe narcissistic is not quite appropriate.
That's a really interesting point. Because if you take someone like, let's say, Justin Bieber, and I mean, I don't know any of his music. I'm sure he's got some talent, but I don't think, you know, again, Justin Bieber fans, feel free to write to me and tell me I'm wrong. I don't think he's got perhaps that much to say to the world. I don't know. Maybe he has. So it must be weird for him. I mean, apparently he's written an autobiography like when he was 18 or something. I can't imagine what was in it, but I guess his upbringing and stuff. But it must be weird for someone like him. I don't know if he ever reflects and think, am I really as amazing as people think, you know?
Yeah, it's hard to tell. I don't get the impression that he does, but then I don't follow him on Instagram and stuff. So I'm not like checking out all the videos and things he makes. Maybe he's just sharing selfies. You know, like Instagram is quite a narcissistic platform, isn't it? There's quite a lot of basically people just taking pictures of themselves wearing nice clothes or in nice locations. There's not really anything else going on other than, hey, I look fucking great.
Yeah, if you actually look at it, if you take a step back, it's a festival of narcissism, social media. And I've been involved in it, I have to admit. You know, I mean, I don't post much on Instagram. But if you really look at it, a friend of mine in Madrid pointed this out to me and I've never forgotten it. It's not that people are narcissists. It's that everything is encouraging narcissism. So maybe you become a narcissist or you don't, or maybe you've got that tendency And I think narcissism, again, just comes from insecurity. It's like jealousy, you know? The people who need it more are going to be the more narcissistic. And when you get a very, very insecure person who becomes world famous, it's really a recipe for disaster. I'm amazed that a lot of them survive, really, you know?
Absolutely, yeah. It's not all bad. I think that it depends on how you use it as well, of course. But yeah, arguably the platform itself is designed in a way that kind of encourages certain types of narcissistic behavior. Let's move on.
We're doing very well at moving quickly, I must say.
I'm not sure about that. So, okay, we've got other words like open. Now, everyone knows what open means, like open-minded, I suppose, and also open to new ideas. Paranoid, I think we have mentioned this. We don't need to go into it in detail, as you said, after taking drugs and things like that and the crazy level of fame that he achieved. He was probably quite paranoid, worried about people and their intentions and stuff.
Justifiably paranoid, I'd say.
Absolutely justifiably paranoid. But it's interesting that, you know, we talked about him being generous and stuff and being generous with fans and he being paranoid. And I understand he had premonitions of his own death.
Yeah. There's a fantastic documentary called Imagine from 1988. There's lots of films called Imagine, so you have to find the right one. Essentially narrated by John Lennon from his interviews. And it's very much official story, but it's a really fantastic film. And at the end, yeah, I was quite surprised. Yoko said there were a lot of premonitions. And John Lennon told his assistant, Fred Seaman, even that he thought he was going to be killed violently. It's quite amazing. And he even makes references. I mean, how about this? At the beginning of Come Together, the song, on the finished one, it just sort of sounds like he's going, shh, do-do-do-do-do. But when you hear the isolated stems, he's actually saying, shoot me. He's saying, shoot me, do-do-do, which is really awful. And then he says, during the bedding, he said, oh, we're willing to be the world's clowns because all the serious people like Kennedy, Martin Luther King and Gandhi got shot. It's so eerie, isn't it?
I think, wasn't it Ian MacDonald in Revolution in the Head? I think there's a section in that book, which I find a pretty dark book, actually.
I haven't read that for so many years, but I remember loving it, yeah.
It's great, but it kind of makes me feel a bit bad when I read some of the things that he wrote about some of the songs. But anyway, one of the comments he made was that somehow John Lennon was playing with fire when in the 60s he was releasing songs that had lots of weird messages, and that by playing with the heads of his fans like he did in songs like Glass Onion, he's kind of trolling his fans to an extent, but at the same time he's not. He's kind of putting out all these weird semi-subliminal messages and twisting people's heads to an extent that might have backfired on him to an extent. Maybe he should have been a bit more careful in terms of messing with the mental health of his crazy fans. When you get to that level of success, then there are a certain number of mentally ill people or disturbed individuals out there. Mm. And, you know, you kind of start to think, well, maybe he should have been more cautious or something. But I suppose he was an artist and he did what he felt he had to do as an artist.
Interesting. We haven't got careful and cautious on our list, have we? So I might answer your question a little bit.
He wasn't that careful or cautious, yeah. That his killer, he just was willing to talk to him in the street and sign an autograph for him and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Maybe he should have been more careful and cautious. But this is the thing that we like about the Beatles. They're not the sorts of people who are like, no, keep the fans away from me. You know, I don't want to have to see all these people. I think some famous people are like that. They have contempt for their fans and they don't want to meet them. They don't want to see them and they feel that they're above them. But I don't think John was like that. Maybe he should have been more careful, but we had a double-edged sword. Like, this is what we like about him, but ultimately this may be something that was bad for him in the end.
Yeah, I mean, I was listening to a journalist actually talking about a journalist who was around in the 60s or maybe in the 70s, and they interviewed Rihanna or someone like that. This is nothing against Rihanna. It's more to do with the culture. And they said, like, the rules that were imposed, oh, you can only have X amount of minutes. You're not allowed to talk about this. You're not allowed to talk about that. They were kept away from Rihanna until the interview started. It was all just massively controlled. And they said, you know, with the Beatles, obviously it was controlled a bit, but it was almost like amateur hour, you know, in terms of the organization. I mean, you know, their road crew was 8 people and they were like the most famous band in the world. It's charmingly naive in a way, isn't it? You know?
Yeah. They didn't really have any bodyguards except Mal Evans, who was like this big, you know, friendly giant. Yeah, they didn't have any security. It's just mad, isn't it?
It's absolutely crazy. What you said about John Lennon, yeah, in a way, yeah, I don't want to be too dark, but I kind of agree with you. He almost did sign his own death warrant, but because he wanted to be true to himself, like, he didn't want to live a fake life. And I think maybe that's one of the things that people admire about him. You know, I'll argue, and I've argued on the show, that a lot of John Lennon's appeal has sort of come down to this post-1980 propaganda. You know, it's like a machine of John Lennon the peacenik. But I think a lot of it is authentic. And interestingly, as soon as he died, before any propaganda was allowed to happen, people were like congregating outside the Dakota and weeping and in tears and saying, you know, this is the death of the 60s. So there is something genuine, you know, that people picked up on. Didn't do him any favors. Absolutely not.
Okay. Oh, it gets a bit dark.
It does.
So, okay, we've got to, I'm going to just say some of these ones. Quick-witted, we said, it's like, you know, he's clever. He's got the gift of the gab. He's able to come up with funny, witty comments off the top of his head, which is another charming thing about him. Reclusive. If someone's reclusive, it means that they kind of stay inside and they don't go out and they don't see people. And, oh, okay, I feel like we're going to talk about that one. Go on.
No, all I'm going to say, as we've already mentioned, this period, 1975 to 80, is the most contentious. And one version has him traveling all the time, being very open, devoted to his son. And the other extreme has him very reclusive. And Caitlin, this lady who's on my show, said he did spend a lot of time in his room. And he would tend to play with Sean and her and be very enthusiastic for 5 or 10 minutes and then get bored and then go back to his room and not be seen again for a few hours. But again, maybe it's a symptom of the fame as well. You know, when you've given that much to people, to the public, you deserve to have some time to yourself. And Elvis ended up the same way, you know, spent a lot of time in his room in the end.
Yeah. That's all. But I mean, so do I. I spend almost all so day in my room. You know, it's weird. Like, we judge people like John differently. If he just spends a day in his room watching TV, he's a recluse. You know, he's reclusive and he's hiding from the world and what's going on. But it's just like, I'm just watching TV.
One of my favorite directors, possibly my favorite, Stanley Kubrick. And what Kubrick did in the 80s was be quote unquote reclusive. But all he did was just not give the press anything to write about, you know, and that was his way of dealing with it. And I actually met someone, a friend of mine, who's a book publisher, who met Kubrick in the 80s and said he was just absolutely lovely. There was no guardedness. He just figured out, a bit like George Harrison, he had moments like this. He just figured out the best way to a happy life is to give the press as little as possible to write about.
Yeah, he wasn't just like sitting there with like really long fingernails. You know, he hasn't had a bath for 3 weeks. That's the picture that gets painted when people say that someone is reclusive.
Howard Hughes is always the poster boy for being reclusive. Reclusive is a tag, and it basically means that the media are not getting what they want. So they have to cast you as some weirdo, you know, never leaves his house.
Yeah. Meanwhile, John Lennon's just watching the wheels.
Watching the wheels go around. Yeah.
Watching the wheels go around, watching shadows on the wall.
Absolutely.
I love that song.
Yeah, I'm going to refer to that later.
Great. Okay, yep. Quick-witted, reclusive, restless. Apparently, he wasn't restless because he would spend quite a lot of time relaxing on the sofa watching the TV, so he wasn't that restless. Guess we all have our moments.
I think I see restless more mentally. He never wanted to be stuck doing the same thing for too long, like musically. I think artistically, he was restless. That's probably the way I'd connect it.
Right, yeah, and he did change a lot. Revered, meaning respected highly. I think that's fair to say that he is revered.
Definitely.
We've got a couple of false friends, sensitive and sensible. A sensitive person might react badly or might be easily affected by criticism or things like that. Do you reckon John was a sensitive guy, or was he a tough guy? Was he thick-skinned, or was he sensitive?
Yeah, well, there's two meanings of sensitive, really. The positive meaning is that if you're a sensitive person, you're sensitive to other people's feelings. And I think he was definitely that. A lot of artistic people, to sort of generalize a bit, they're a bit like that. You know, they're very attuned to feelings. But then the other meaning of sensitive, which I'd probably call oversensitive, is like if someone says, oh, you know, you have a new pair of shoes and say, oh, God, I don't like those. You know, it's going to bother you for the rest of the day. It's a silly example, but too easily hurt, perhaps, or offended. So that would be like thin-skinned, yeah, as opposed to thick-skinned. On the note of false friends, you're absolutely right. Yeah, sensible in Spanish is sensitive.
So sensitive, we've done. Sensible.
Probably not, no.
He's not very sensitive. He wasn't very sensible.
No. Right, probably, again, multifaceted. So I'm sure there was a sensible side to him. But it's probably just not one of the first traits that would come to mind.
If you're sensible, your decisions are carefully thought through. You use reason, logic in your decision making. But John was probably a lot more reckless or emotionally driven. He did things which arguably were quite dangerous and risky, like, you know, using certain drugs and being quite compulsive.
Impulsive as well.
Impulsive. Yeah. Okay, we've got a few left. Only a few left. Okay, sentimental, superstitious. I like these adjectives. I think we've got maybe about five more adjectives left, including these. So we can talk a little bit about these. In John's song, In My Life, from Rubber Soul, and also Strawberry Fields, there's a sense that he's looking back at the past with a lot of emotion and maybe even rose-tinted spectacles to an extent.
The way that people get stereotyped, Paul is sentimental and John isn't. Not true at all. Just a quick word on the song In My Life. I'm fairly convinced that was a 50-50 composition.
Oh, really?
I feel like John often gets a lot of credit. And then Paul wrote his book many years from now in the 90s. And someone said, oh, when I read that book, the first thing that came to my head was like, oh, yeah, all right, calm down, mate. We know you were a good songwriter. He's kind of got cast as revising history, but I feel like stuff like that was a bit of a 50-50. John Lennon, there are stories about him in the 70s on his jukebox. He'd have like Bing Crosby and stuff like that, you know, which you'd never imagine with John Lennon, would you?
Sentimental, meaning like showing a lot of love or pity, showing lots of emotion, but it's considered to be exaggerated and foolish. Like, you know, a lot of American films, the ending of American films often is quite sentimental.
Rom-com.
Where everything's like, oh my God, I love you. You know, do you remember the Wonder Years?
Yeah, yeah.
What would you do if I sang out of tune? Which had
that's
that
a great impersonation.
Had that song at the start. But the Wonder Years was about the life of just an average young boy in America. But it was really sentimental. Like every story was quite good, that he got into some trouble or whatever. And his dad was quite frightening character. But then the story would always be sentimental at the end. It was like, and that was when I realized that I really loved my dad. You know, yeah. That kind of thing. It's like
glorifying the past a bit, as you said. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Ringo did an album called Sentimental Journey, of course, which was sort of old standards, which I've never actually listened to all the way through. Gets panned a bit, but I quite like Ringo's voice, actually. Don't really like his songs much, his solo albums, but I do like his voice.
Superstitious. Very superstitious. Was he quite superstitious?
I'm not sure. He had this thing about the number nine.
Number nine?
Yeah, there you go.
Can't help it. I can't help it at all. Whenever I'm teaching and the number nine comes up, I always have to go, okay, number nine, number nine, number nine. And I do it on my podcast too. And there's probably about a handful of people who get the reference.
Do you ever play it backwards? Turn me on, dead man. Turn me on, dead man.
It's not turn me on, dead man. Either it's turn me on, dead man. Turn me on, dead man.
What I love about Revolution 9, we did a whole episode on it, because I actually consider it a major piece of work. I like Musique Concrète. It's the conversation at the beginning where he says, Alistair Taylor says to George Martin, I'll have got your claret for you if you'd realise. I'm sorry, George. George Martin, we'll do next time. Will you forgive me? And George Martin says, yes. Sounded like that's the very beginning, the very first thing you hear just before the number nine. Revolution 9 is amazing. I want to hear the 5.1 mix because apparently it's scary. It's the stuff of nightmares.
Yeah. Oh, it is scary and amazing. I love it. Yeah, I like that kind of music. And I like the orb. It's very weird, and there are lots of samples of speech in there and other odd things. There's like space journeys, and I love that stuff. And Revolution 9 for me is like that kind of thing. It's just like ambient music, like crazy ambient music.
Well, if you like that sort of moon science fiction-y sort of thing, then Jimi Hendrix, interestingly, had that side to him. What's the song that's like 15 minutes or something?
1983, A Merman I Shall Be, or something like that.
That's it, 1983, yeah. But there's some other stuff. There's a couple of other ones as well on Axis Bold as Love, I think.
Yeah, there's the beginning of Axis Bold as Love, which is like a radio show. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to radio station EXP. Tonight we feature an interview with a very, very odd-looking gentleman who goes by the name of Mr. Paul Caruso.
That's it, yeah.
On the dodgy subject of, are there or are there not UFOs? And then Jimi Hendrix comes in and goes, excuse me, I must be on my way. And then the sounds of feedback on guitars and things. And with his guitar, he makes the sound of a UFO taking off. It's like, whoa, that's brilliant.
Here's a bit of, if you're a Hendrix fan, here's some great trivia. You know the song Third Stone from the Sun?
Yeah.
He goes, I went to see a Jimi Hendrix tribute band when I was very young, 18 or 19. And they said that we think Jimmy might have been watching Coronation Street in the 60s.
Oh, yeah.
He used to say,
da-na-na-na-na-na.
I'd say it was brilliant. They played Coronation Street in a Jimi Hendrix style before they played Third Stone from the Sun. It's absolutely brilliant. Of course, the song Fire, this is, oh, sorry for going on tangents.
But it's all right.
Fire comes from Noel Redding's mum. Noel Redding was a bass player, and she used to love Jimmy. She thought he was really nice, and she used to worry about him, be very protective. She said, oh, what that boy needs is a mother, you know? And one night they were very cold, and Jimi Hendrix said, oh, can I stand next to your fire? Let me stand next to your fire.
Let me stand next to your fire.
He sort of turned it into something quite sexy, but it's very, very innocuous origins.
Yeah, it was actually, I'm kind of cold. Can I stand next to your fire?
To a middle-aged lady, you know, not to a sexy woman. You know.
In some front room in England on like a cold right. February morning, evening or something.
Exactly. While watching Coronation Street. Can I watch Coronation Street in front of your fire? I'm going to compose two songs.
That's great. I'm so glad that Jimi Hendrix spent that time in England. Okay, but superstitious. I mean, didn't he sort of do tarot card readings and stuff like that?
Yeah, well, Yoko, again, this is even in the official version now, was very obsessed with tarot and numerology. And I think she just got John into that. I'm not sure if he was totally into it, but, you know, consulting the I Ching and stuff as a Ruttles reference. Barry started consulting the I Ching every 5 minutes.
Yeah. Talented. Okay, moving through the adjectives again. Talented, yes. Traumatized. I think we talked about it. You know, obviously the death of certain key people in his life probably gave him trauma. Well-read. This is going to be the last one. I mean, I'm going to mention the X adjectives and the Z adjectives too. I will do them. But we have said this before. If someone is well-read, it means that they've read a lot of books. And he was incredibly well-read.
Yeah, one of the things that we get onto the lyrics in a minute, there's a literate quality to them. And this is one of the ways that he's inspired me. Because I was not naturally a reader. I mean, I used to read kids' books when I was a kid, obviously. But I was more of a radio guy, actually. I think that's how I found my way to podcasts. Obviously, I used to watch a lot of TV like any kids, but I was always very drawn to the radio, the sort of mystery of it. But I've become in my adult life a voracious reader and podcast consumer as well. And I have to credit John Lennon for that, because there's loads of pictures. Like these are obviously not the very publicized pictures, but whenever you see pictures of them on holiday, very often he's got his nose in a book. And I think reading is such a wonderful thing. Yeah, sitting down with a good book, nothing better.
Yeah, definitely. So I was struggling to think of an adjective that began with X, and the only one I could think of, and this doesn't apply to John Lennon, I think, is xenophobic, which is when you're, you know, I guess it's the fear of people from other countries.
If I could just say one thing about that, in fact, it's the opposite, because Liverpool, traditionally, because it's a port, was very multicultured. So, in fact, the Beatles had the opposite instinct, whereas a lot of, and I mean, my dad, unfortunately, was subject to quite a bit of, not open racism, but more like veiled racism, more ignorance when he came to England. So that was one thing the Beatles had in their favour. They'd grown up in a multicultural place.
Yeah, it's interesting then. Okay, so xenophobic is quite appropriate because the Beatles were absolutely not xenophobic. In fact, they were really interested in people from other countries, and Liverpool being a melting pot of cultures, people sort of often forget just how diverse the place was, and it being a port town and this old industrial city that was such an important place in the UK. And so many people came through the city. And it's got, you know, a big Chinese community. There's like an Afro-Caribbean community there. And obviously they saw the world. And I think John was like very, very curious and interested in other cultures and things. Then we got the words zealous and the word zen. Now, normally we say overzealous, don't we?
Yeah, zealous has a slightly negative connotation, perhaps because it's connected with religion and the idea of religious fanatics, let's say. But I think zeal really is to do with enthusiasm, isn't it? Zealous comes from the noun zeal, that to do with being very passionate and very enthusiastic about something. But it's probably not a word I'd recommend people use, because it has that negative association.
Yeah, as you said, we associate it with fanaticism. Zeal, according to collinsdictionary.com, is great enthusiasm, especially in connection with work, religion, or politics. So you can talk about having a zeal for teaching, for example, but then we have things like religious zeal, which is when you start to get into the sort of religious fanaticism and the negative connotations that are associated with that.
I think maybe zeal doesn't have it. Zealous has more of the connotation than zeal, in fact.
Someone who's zealous spends a lot of time or energy in supporting something that they believe in very strongly, especially a political or religious ideal.
So or a 60s pop group.
Yeah, you get these zealous fans.
There you go.
Overzealous as well. But was Lennon zealous or overzealous? Was he particularly enthusiastic about certain causes, like religious or political causes?
Not so much religious. I think he was very childlike. That's probably an adjective we could have used, as opposed to childish. I think childish is very negative, that you're behaving like a child in an immature way.
Yeah.
Childlike is that you have quite a charming, childlike innocence about you, which is kind of what he had. He was sort of streetwise and innocent and naive at the same time. That's why he's so interesting. But yeah, he definitely would have enthusiasms, much like a child would have a strong enthusiasm for something, and then he would seem to go off it very quickly. And one of the John Lennon books sort of said, you know, for 18 months he was this, he was into acid. Then for the next 18 months he was into peace. Next 18 months, anti-war, new left politics. So he sort of gets tagged as someone who flits from one thing to another. So I think zealous, passionate, yeah, definitely.
He never did anything by halves. So whatever he was into at the time was like, you know, almost like a big obsession for him. And he would be probably quite zealous about whatever it was he was doing. But passionate, yeah, it's probably a better word because it's got more positive connotations. Right. And then finally, we have the word Zen. And so Zen or Zen Buddhism is a form of Buddhist religion that concentrates on meditation. But we do describe things as being Zen. So this is the noun Zen I've just mentioned, but Zen can be an adjective, I think, too. What does it mean if someone is Zen, would you say?
I would say it means that they're able to be very still and not be overtaken by their emotions, be able to stand back. And this is very interesting because, again, one of the contradictions, and I mean in a good way, charming contradictions, is John, is that he had loads of manic energy, but he was also, apparently he was very good at meditation. You know, when they're in India, you know, he's very zealous, there you go, yeah, about meditation. So he had that Zen side, and he also took a vow of silence. And Caitlin, who was on the show, she said she thought it was maybe a parenting hack, but he didn't have to spend too much time marshalling the children. So he took a vow of silence for, I think it was 7 days. I can't remember, but what a character, eh?
Yeah, absolutely.
But yeah, Zen, yeah, sort of a stillness, a calmness of mind as much of body. I think he had that, yeah.
Okay, so we've just been through our fairly long list of adjectives of personality referring to John Lennon. Now, we've done that. So we've got one more thing to do, which is to finally talk about the music and the lyrics. And this is going to be the final part of our episode.
I actually went through a book of Beatles lyrics. And to be honest, most of the examples I'm citing here are John Lennon's Beatles songs. I didn't find so many in the solo years, but general comments, Beatles lyrics were quite literate. They all went to grammar schools, or the main three guys. And John and Paul certainly liked Alice in Wonderland, which is where you get a lot of imagery. When they were growing up in the 50s, I think Chuck Berry was probably the only songwriter who really had narratives in his lyrics. If you make a comparison, I love Buddy Holly. I could listen to Buddy Holly's 20 greatest hits forever. But the lyrics are quite simple. You know, they're great. But Chuck Berry had these pithy kind of stories.
Chuck Berry's amazing. His lyrics are absolutely brilliant. Yeah, as you said, little stories, narratives, very poetic and very articulate. I think he's really underestimated as a lyricist.
But the sort of tradition in those days, in the early 60s, would be simplicity. And one of the things that's very interesting, the first five Beatles singles, Love Me Do, Please Please Me, From Me to You, She Loves You, I Want to Hold Your Hand, pronouns. And it was a deliberate thing. I don't know if it was deliberate while they were writing the songs, but they clearly had it in mind. It was a way of reaching out to the fans, saying from me to you or from us to you. And they had a TV show or something, a radio show called From Us to You. Anyway, so it was very direct. But do you know the story of how John Lennon came to start using more imagery in his lyrics?
No, I don't. I think I don't, no.
It's a sort of mixture of things. Have you ever read his books, his first two books, In His Own Right and A Splendid in the Works?
Yeah, I've read a lot of those. Yeah, my mum and dad had those books. So they were on the bookshelves growing up. And my brother and I used to sometimes pick them up and just sort of like leaf through and see. Yeah, funny poems, basically.
There's some great stuff. There's loads of social commentary. And it's a sort of nonsense, but nonsense in a good way. And my favourite one is he describes Princess Margaret as priceless margarine. Which is just brilliant because it's a dig. He's having a little dig at the Royals, but yeah, in a gentle way.
I guess the thing about Lennon's prose is that he would find ways in which words sounded like other words, and then he would turn them into those other words. There's that famous one about the General Erection.
General Erection.
The General Erection over the torchies.
With the small Marjorie over the torchies.
With the small Marjorie over the torchies, which is a small majority over the Tories. And then something about entering Powell.
Yeah, an abscess of Powell. Something like that. I can't remember. I haven't read it, but we can do a show about it fairly soon. I'll send it to you when we've done it.
Okay.
As you all know, Harris Wilsard won the general election with a very small Marjorie over the torchies, thus putting the Labouring Party back into Powell after a large abscess. This he could not have done without span the barking of the trade unions, headed by Frank Cunnings, who now has a safe seat in non-eating, thank you.
And stuff like there was a politician called Alec Douglas Home, or Whom, and he has him as Alice Doubtless Whom. So you've got Alice, you know, you've got casting him as a female. There's just so much in that book, but you don't think for a second that John Lennon thought it all out. You know, it's clearly just coming out of this amazing brain that he had.
Yeah.
But what I was going to say was that he did an interview with a BBC journalist called Kenneth Allsop. And after the interview, Kenneth Allsop said to John Lennon, I've noticed, you know, why don't your song lyrics have all this clever imagery in them? And he said, well, you know, I think if song lyrics is one thing and writing is another thing. And he said, well, why don't you do that? And John Lennon thought, And then when Bob Dylan, marijuana and LSD came into his life, that was really where the transition came. So suddenly you get all this imagery. So there's a definite sort of demarcation point around 65, I'd probably say, maybe even 64, where the lyrics started to change. And Paul pretty much kept up with him.
People often say this is another the sort of John Paul dichotomy, which is not really the case, that people often reductively say John Lennon was the lyrics guy, Paul was the melody or music guy. That's also not really true. Paul came up with great lyrics and John also had some great melodies in there too. But actually, looking through a list of Beatles songs that I've got on Spotify, and I was thinking, I wonder which songs I would pick in terms of lyrics. Almost all of them were John Lennon songs. There are a few Paul ones in there too, like I love Fool on the Hill, She's Leaving Home, and a lot of his songs. But oddly, the ones that stuck out for me are John's songs.
It's not an either or, you know, it's not 100% either way.
Yeah.
Can I show you? These are all my examples. I'm not going to be able to go through all of them, am I? See, I've done my homework there.
Let's just do what we can in the time we've got.
Okay.
As a general rule of life.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'll let you choose and pick and choose whatever you want to do.
Okay. Well, I might sing a few and I've got my guitar here. I'm not going to be giving performances, don't worry. But I try to divide these into sections. But I'll get you to, let's do Guess the Song. I'm going to love her till the cows come home. I'm going to love her till the cows come home. It's
When I Get Home.
Very impressive. This is deep Beatles, When I Get Home. This is not well-known songs. I got a chip on my shoulder that's bigger than my feet.
I'll Cry Instead.
Very good. So you got The Cows Come Home, Chip on My Shoulder, which we talked about.
Sorry, When the Cows Come Home, meaning for a long time. I'm going to do something until the cows come home for a long time.
Yeah. And it's funny that those two lyrics, he gets sort of a bit lambasted for. I mean, they're a bit clunky. I've got a chip on my shoulder that's bigger than my feet. It's not the greatest lyric in the world. Well, my heart went boom when I crossed that room, etc.
Yeah, it's she was just 17. Saw her standing there, of course, yeah.
Yeah, that's My Heart Went Boom. So that's an onomatopoeia. You know, you make the sound of it like buzz or hum. So boom.
His heart went boom as he crossed that room.
That's it. This one you won't have to guess because this is the title. It won't be long till I belong to you. So a little bit of wordplay. It won't be long until I belong to you.
Very nice.
That's quite nice. Easy one. I don't know why she's riding so high. She ought to think twice, she ought to do right by me.
Ticket to Ride.
Ticket to Ride. Very good. So riding so high. The idea of being really happy, I suppose. Riding
I sort of imagine like riding high in the saddle, like as if she's up on a horse, which suggests that maybe she's even on her high horse, which is like when someone feels morally superior.
I think there is a drug connotation as well. They loved putting those sort of sneaky references in. So it's a bit like that. I think riding so high would be like if you're on a high, if like your life's going well or something. That's the way I look at it. I think they were still at the point where the lyrics didn't always really make sense. It wasn't really a narrative, you know? I think that came a bit later.
Yeah.
Should we carry on? I don't know the chord to it. I'll make a point of taking her away from you. Watch what you do.
Hey, well, you treat her. What else can I do? You're going to lose that girl.
Very good, yeah. So I'll make a point of, I'm going to make a special effort to do this. I'll make a point of taking her away from you.
The lyrics in that are great.
Yeah, yeah, it's brilliant. Here we go.
I sat on a rug, biding my time, drinking her wine.
It's Norwegian word, open brackets, this bird has flown, close brackets.
And the bird may refer to the English word for lady. This bird has flown. This bird has flown.
That's a great song, but that's got a kind of a story to it.
Yeah, he was having an affair. I mean, this is kind of the dark side of John Lennon. He was having an affair with a lady called Sunny Freeman, and they actually lived in the flat upstairs or downstairs. I can't remember. So John and Cynthia are on one floor. Robert Freeman, who was a photographer who took some iconic photos of the Beatles, and his wife or girlfriend, well, his wife, yeah, Sunny Freeman. And John and Sunny Freeman were having an affair. Norwegian wood refers to very modern furniture. So the idea was that this is kind of a modern lady. And it's interesting as well, because she leaves him, lying in the bath? No, sleeps in the bath. She uses him almost, uses him for what she wants. But then they set the house on fire, which apparently was Paul McCartney's idea.
Yeah, at the end of the song, they actually burned down the house. Yeah, it's definitely worth a listen. This is great. Let's keep going.
Okay, that was Biding My Time, by the way. So biding my time, taking my time to see what happens, you know.
Yeah, to bide your time. One thing, I feel like you're going chronologically here. Am I right?
Yeah, a little bit. I kind of put it into wordplay, and then I've got some stuff on colours, which is quite interesting.
Yeah.
And then we get to the surreal imagery. So yeah, in a rough chronology, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Please don't spoil my day, I'm miles away, and after all,
I'm only sleeping. Dun, 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 dun,
dun. There you go. I'm miles away. Again, brilliant double meaning, because again, it's almost certainly a sort of a pot reference. Miles away means I'm daydreaming. I'm not paying attention. You know. Oh, this is a good one. Yeah.
If she's gone, I can't go on feeling 2 foot small.
You've got to hide your love away.
Very good. The Beatles liked happy accidents. So the original lyric was feeling 2 foot tall, but I think he just sang by accident feeling 2 foot small. And of course it worked perfectly, because then suddenly you're feeling small, like you're very insecure, lacking in confidence.
Is it a phrase that is sometimes used, like to feel 2 foot tall?
No, I think you'd say I feel 10 feet tall, wouldn't you?
Right.
That's what people say. Again, it's a bit like riding so high. You're just feeling really happy with everything.
It's interesting to sort of understand how maybe in song lyrics you get from a phrase that people know that's commonly used, and the songwriter has gone from that place to another place, which creates a sort of interesting image or something. So I feel 10 foot tall is like what you'd say if you felt really proud of yourself. Like, you know, well done, you've got the award, you know, here you go, congratulations, how do you feel? Oh, I'll tell you what, I feel 10 foot tall. I don't know why I'm doing it in a northern accent, but I am.
So I feel 10 foot tall.
I feel 10 foot tall. This is amazing. But then John singing, I'm feeling 2 foot small, feeling kind of ashamed or belittled or something.
Maybe the genius is going with the accident. They all had that sense of, well, I got it wrong. Yeah, but that sounds better than the original lyric. Go with it. And I think they were lucky. I'm not going to say a big part of their success because that was a bone of contention, but George Martin, they 100% had the best producer they could possibly get.
Yeah.
And I think he was on board with that. Weirdly enough, do you know that he was actually apparently more working class than any of them?
Mm.
He suddenly got this posh accent, and then it was like, oh, yes, chaps, you know.
Okay, boys.
Let's
take it from the top. Okay, boys. Got an absolutely cut glass, upper class English accent like this, and he's thoroughly posh. But he, in fact, came from a very poor background. This was in the days when acquiring that accent was considered fine, in fact, a good thing to do, that it was all part of bettering yourself. And that's why it's called, I guess, why it's called received pronunciation, because you sort of receive it, you learn it. An amazing success story himself. I mean, the Beatles story is just full of these incredible individuals who just, I guess, by chance, all ended up working together. You were saying George Martin was perfect for them because he also had worked with comedians before and stuff, and so he was able to incorporate the comedy of the Beatles into their work. It didn't put him off. Like, some producers would have been unable to deal with it And they were like, you know, oh, I can't handle these Beatles. But George encouraged it and liked it and was able to work with it.
They all had this subversive side. I think that's what it comes down to.
Yeah.
So again, taking something that people know and then subverting it, just sort of changing it a little bit.
The Beatles lyrics are, they've got sort of jokes in them, but not full on blatant jokes. But there are things that I feel refer to other phrases or other things that everyone knows, and they twist them slightly, like changing certain phrases with other words to give a slightly different flavor.
The Ruttles just came to mind. One of the geniuses of Neil Innes, who wrote those Ruttle songs, taking the idea of using phrases for the song Help, he came up with a song called Ouch. Ouch, you're breaking my heart. And he talks about upsetting the apple cart. So he's doing this brilliant thing where the Beatles didn't generally use necessarily idioms and proverbs. So Neil Innes had the thought, well, why don't I use some really clunky idioms for comedic effect? And, you know, there's a song, All You Need Is Love. He did Love Life, where there's a will, there's a way. It's brilliant.
There's another one in that. All his lyrics, including his non-Ruttle stuff, are full of these sort of platitudes, these sorts of like sayings that your mother would know. Some of his songs, some of his other songs that are not Ruttle's ones, are almost entirely made up of those kinds of sayings. Like, do you know the one Spaghetti Western?
Oh, I don't know if I've heard that, actually.
It's a bit obscure. It's from his Innes Book of Records TV show, and he also recorded the song for one of his albums. And it's a kind of pastiche of a Spaghetti Western song.
Like a gunman wears a gun, he wore a gun. And people stepped aside because he was no good. 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 Because of bad luck, he never knew a mother's love. He was like a wolf in sheep's clothing, or an iron hand in a velvet.
And people stepped aside because he was no good. And it's not because he was no good morally, but literally he was no good with the gun. Like, he couldn't shoot straight. That's why people were stepping aside. And other things like, he was like a wolf in a sheep's clothing, or an iron hand in a velvet glove.
It's almost like he's taken a list of idioms and thought, which ones can I use?
Yeah, absolutely.
There wasn't the internet then, was there? So,
I think it was all in his head. I think, you know, that's just the genius of Neil Innes, yeah.
There's a great bit of wordplay, actually. The song that's supposed to be Get Back is called Get Up and Go. But he has a great double meaning of it. He had a lot of get up and go, which is obviously a lot of energy.
Yeah.
And then he says, get up and go back home. Get up and go back home.
He didn't have a lot of what you might call luck, but he had a lot of get up and go. Get up and go. Get up and go. Get up and go back home.
Yeah.
Just absolutely brilliant. I think comedy records are an absolute art. I mean, Brave Sir Robin from the Holy Grail. They talk
brave,
about all
Brave Sir Robin, Sir Robin.
Yeah, when danger reared its ugly head, he bravely fled or something. He's talking about he runs away from the three-headed, what's that?
Oh. Monty Python and the Holy Grail, which follows the Knights of the Round Table. And one of them is called Sir Robin. And he's followed by his band of minstrels who play songs wherever he goes. And the lead minstrel is played by Neil Innes in the film. His band of minstrels are singing about how brave he is.
Bravely bold Sir Robin, brought forth from Camelot. He was not afraid to die, oh brave Sir Robin. He was not at all afraid to be killed in nasty ways. Brave, 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 brave Sir Robin. He was not in the least bit scared to be mashed into a pulp, or to have his eyes gouged out and his elbows broken, to have his kneecap split and his body burned away, and his limbs all hacked and mangled, brave Sir Robin. His head smashed in and his heart cut out and his liver removed and his bowels unplugged and his nostrils raked and his bottom burnt off and his penis...
That's enough music for now, lads. Looks like there's dirty work afoot.
Then when Robin actually does come across a monster, he runs away. And then the minstrels are like taunting him. Brave Sir Robin ran away.
No!
bravely ran away, away.
I didn't.
When danger reared its ugly head, he bravely turned his tail and fled. Yes, brave Sir Robin turned about.
I didn't.
Gallantly he chickened out, bravely taking.
I never did.
Feet. He beat a very brave retreat.
Oh, Lord.
Bravest of the brave, Sir Robin.
He's talking about all the horrible things that can happen, like disemboweling and things. Da, da, da. And then they get to his and his penis. Oh, stop. I'm not going to play this, but double meanings again. Day tripper could be someone going on a day trip to the beach. Or again, it could be someone who takes LSD at the weekend and then has a normal straight life. Again, it's almost like a quite pointed social comment there. Ticket to Ride. Interestingly, there is a place called Ride on the Isle of Wight, R-Y-D-E. May have been a sort of nod to that.
Almost like a little in-joke, I guess, between the members of the band.
That's it, yeah.
They probably did get a ticket to Ride, and that's a good name for a song, though. Should write a song about that. Ticket to Ride.
Yeah. And this one, I mean, again, the title's here. It's been a hard day's night, and I've been working like a dog. It's been a hard day's night, I've been sleeping like a log. So similes, working like a dog, sleeping like a log.
Yes, and we have so many of those similes in English.
If you need a shoulder to cry on, I hope it will be mine.
Da, 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 da,
don't you
da,
be da, sad, da, da. Just call me tonight.
Anytime at all, down, 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 anytime at all, anytime at all.
Yep. I think John Lennon would give people a shoulder to cry on, going back to the adjectives. I think there's quite a lot of evidence for that. He was quite a caring person, had that caring side.
If someone was upset, yes, to give someone a shoulder to cry on, which is like to be sympathetic to someone. You're willing to listen to their problems and let them cry on your shoulder. Not necessarily literally, but there it is. To give someone a shoulder to cry on.
Now fine, I've changed my mind. I've opened up the doors.
Help.
My independence seems to vanish in the haze. So a couple of things. Open up the doors. Again, we think maybe because he just had his first LSD experience, it could be to do with The Doors of Perception, the famous book by Aldous Huxley. And then my independence seems to vanish in the haze. I mean, that's quite big for mid-60s pop lyrics. It's not the kind of thing you'd expect to find.
My independence seems to vanish in the haze. Again, it could be a drug reference because haze could refer to smoke in the air when the air isn't completely clear. For example, if you look out across the city, you get fog or smog in the air. There's haze, there's pollution in the air. But similarly, it could be smoke in a room. And they were smoking quite a lot of marijuana at the time.
For breakfast.
And so there probably would have been haze around. And his independence may have vanished in the haze, you know, his sense of his own identity being lost in the midst of this circus that you talked about.
Yeah, it's almost like a haze of drugs and Beatles fame, you know, put those two things together and anyone would be a bit hazy.
Mm-hmm.
Right, colours. I found some colour references in Beatles songs. Where I can go when I feel low, when I feel blue, and it's my mind.
There is a place.
There's a place. Very good. Yeah. So when I feel blue, it's kind of an Americanism.
To feel blue, meaning feeling sad, feeling a bit depressed.
Not sure if people use that. Does that seem like a bit old-fashioned? I don't know.
People would probably say feeling down rather than feeling blue these days. But, you know, it's the sort of thing that might pop up here and there. You might notice it, but I think it's probably less than it used to be.
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody's green. I'm the one who won your love. You're talking that way. Da, da,
da, da. So please listen to me if you want to stay my.
I told you before.
Oh, yeah. You can't do that.
Can't do that. Very good. Yes. Yeah. So everybody's green, green with envy. So I've got the girl that everybody wants.
Yeah.
They're all jealous or envious.
Green meaning jealous. So green is also used to mean something else as well. Green meaning inexperienced. Especially in American English, it's the sort of thing that you notice in TV shows and stuff that we watch.
Yeah, I mean, people say that about Brian Epstein, that he was well out of his depth when he started.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't a pop manager, but he just had this genuine devotion to the Beatles.
If you wear red tonight, scarlet were the clothes she wore.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, fantastic. How good were the Beatles' B-sides? Oh, I've got a B-side here, Rain. Oh, I've got a B-side, Revolution. Not bad.
Yeah, and yes, it is. Yeah, amazing harmonies, beautiful vocal harmonies. showing, again, yet more range. It was another string to their bow.
Apparently his mother, Julia, used to wear red. She was using red and scarlet. Interesting, a scarlet woman, a woman who's been shamed. In the old days where sex outside marriage was a terrible thing, if a woman had been found to have had sex with someone, that she was called a scarlet woman. Oh, I think that's right.
Oh, right, really?
Very old-fashioned. I mean, I don't think anyone would ever say that anymore. But.
It's the sort of thing that, you know, Beatles being well-read and stuff like that, it might have been an image that there was just in their heads. Yeah, scarlet woman, according to dictionary.com, they say a sexually promiscuous woman or a woman who commits adultery. Yeah, it's certainly not something we use these days, but it's there, and it's maybe in old books and things. So a scarlet woman. Oh, interesting that. Yeah, scarlet were the clothes she wore. So a scarlet woman. Yeah, what's going on there in that song?
Julia was, his mother was quite promiscuous. She was quite ahead of her time in a funny way. And it's fascinating and tragic to think of what she would have been in the 60s, you know, seeing her son's fame. I mean, it's heartbreaking, really, isn't it?
Yeah. It is.
Mm. All right. Very interesting. This is a good piece of... okay, you don't have to guess this because this is the title. Actually, I'll play the beginning. Oh, dear, what can I do? So what are you getting?
Babies in black.
Babies in black. Babies in black and I'm feeling blue. So a nice bit of black and babies in black and I'm feeling blue. This could be a reference to another woman, Astrid, to do with the fact that Stuart Sutcliffe had died and she tended to wear black. Which I think she wore that anyway because it was connected with art, you know. But yeah, nice bit of wordplay. Baby's in black and I feel blue. Yeah.
Yeah. I always, you know, these little things, these little clues or hints, whenever I listen to Beatles songs, I'm always kind of speculating in my head about what they could mean. And when you say that, you know, Baby's in black, you know, it's about Astrid, who was their friend from Hamburg, and she would wear black because she was an existentialist. Exes, they used to call them. Then Stuart Sutcliffe, John's best friend, fell in love with Astrid. Although I wonder if the others had a crush on her too, but Stuart was the one that ended up with her. And then Stuart tragically died of a brain hemorrhage. So baby's in black and I'm feeling blue. I don't know. Is there anything to it? Maybe.
And again, his caring side came out. Astrid has said many times, you know, he was amazing after Stuart died. All right, next one. But now we're getting to imagery and more sort of veiled references. When the sun shines, they slip into the shade and sip their lemonade.
Yeah, so it's rain. When the sun shines, they slip into the shade and sip their lemonade.
This is very much open to interpretation, but one interpretation is it's about people hiding away from the truth. So the sun might be, I don't know, like the new liberated era, and they don't want to be part of it. So they slip in the shade and sip their lemonade. It's like they're running away from it. I think he may have mentioned that. That's the only reason I would say that, you know, because you could almost say anything about anything, couldn't you? Mm. You know, you could read anything into these kind of lyrics, but just a B-side.
One of their best songs, definitely. And the basis of Oasis's entire musical catalogue is the song Rain. But certainly those lyrics in that song, like John is showing contempt for people who he feels, I don't know which people it is exactly, but just ordinary people who haven't woken up, because this is in his post-LSD period. So when the sun shines, they go outside to have their picnics and stuff. And when the sun shines, they escape from the sun. And then when the rain comes, they run and hide their heads.
That's it. It's like hiding. Yeah, they're hiding, you know.
Yeah, always hiding away from the elements, the elemental forces that are coming towards them. They run and hide their heads. They might as well be dead.
It's funny with Revolver, there's lots and lots of references to death. I think that was a big change, you know, Rubber Soul. George said Rubber Soul and Revolver could have been part one and part two. I don't agree with that at all. I think, you know, suddenly they're talking about death, ego death, literal death. Quite amazing.
Yeah, it's true. Like so many of the songs on Revolver are about death. Taxman, you know, for those who die, put a penny on each eye.
Declare the pennies on your eyes. That's a great line.
Declare the pennies on your eyes.
Declare it as tax, yeah.
This is from the old tradition, which was that when people died, pennies, coins would be put over their eyes, first of all, to cover their eyes, but secondly, to pay, the person taking the body away.
Yeah, I don't know. You might be right. I know it's definitely to cover the eyes, yeah.
The song is about, you know, George complaining about having to pay tax. But fair enough, they paid something like 90% in those
days. One for you, 19 for me, which means 19 out of every 20 goes to the government.
Yeah. But yeah, so many of the songs on the album reference death in some way. It's a pretty dark album.
It is, isn't it?
Even in the, you know, the last song, Tomorrow Never Knows, he's like, you know, turn off your mind, relax and float downstream. It is not dying.
This is not a line, but a song with tangerine trees and marmalade skies, cellophane flowers, newspaper taxis. What would that be?
It's Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds.
Absolutely. Well, yeah, a couple of things about that. I'm pretty sure that Paul contributed a lot to this because they did have writing sessions around Sgt. Pepper. Their writing partnership tended to come sort of in and out. Rubber Soul, they wrote a lot of that together. I think when they were under time pressure, that's when they would actually get down to it and have these famous three-hour writing sessions. But, yeah, very interesting. This really is a sort of combination of Alice in Wonderland and LSD, rather like, if you know the Jefferson Airplane song, White Rabbit,
mm-hmm.
take this pill, and one pill makes you larger. And that's Alice in Wonderland, but clearly it's LSD as well. And interestingly, Lewis Carroll, I read a book years ago about creativity. Lewis Carroll used to have terrible migraines. And apparently he would get visions. So Lewis Carroll was getting psychedelic visions 100 years before John Lennon.
Lewis Carroll, the man who wrote Alice in Wonderland and a big influence on John Lennon. Yeah, because there's always been speculation about whether Lewis Carroll was somehow using psychedelics and if psychedelic experiences had influenced Alice in Wonderland. But powerful migraine headaches can produce hallucinations and visions. Amazing, and things. Yeah, okay, interesting that.
We reviewed a book, very, very good Beatles book, Riding So High, The Beatles and Drugs. And it's a very, very even-handed look at their relationship with drugs, good and bad. LSD was synthesized in a laboratory by Albert Hofmann. It was either Germany or Switzerland. Anyway, in 1943, I think he ingested it by accident once. And then he did it on purpose. And he famously went off riding on his bike. And in the book, they quote what he wrote about this experience. And it's so funny to see a German or Swiss scientist in 1943. I joked he wrote Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds then, because it's not quite as surreal, but he just describes these amazing visions. You know, that's during the war. It's during the Second World War. That's decades removed from the 1960s.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Okay, so we're going to do a quick fire round now where you just say a line and I will identify the song. And we're not going to go deep into the lyrics, but we may come back for another episode at a later date where we do go into more detail about these things. So quick fire round then.
Okay. No One I Think Is In My Tree.
That is Strawberry Fields Forever.
So he's using my tree as an image of on my wavelength, basically, like I'm either a genius or I'm mad or both.
Mm-hmm.
Semolina Pilchard Climbing Up the Eiffel Tower.
That's I'm the Walrus.
So that's a bizarre imagery, but it does make a reference to Sergeant Pilcher, who was the one who started busting pop stars.
The police officer who was, yeah, arresting the pop stars for possession of drugs.
Next one. The clouds will be a daisy chain, so let me see you smile again.
Dear Prudence.
Dear Prudence. So that's an image. The clouds will be a daisy chain. It's lots of childlike imagery. Yeah. That was famously written about Mia Farrow's sister in India, who would lock herself in her room meditating all day. A hair of floating sky is shimmering, glimmering in the sun.
Julia.
Julia, yeah. So a hair of floating sky. Again, this is quite Dylan-esque. This is what he got from Bob Dylan, the idea of just putting images that don't really make sense, but they evoke a hair of floating sky is shimmering. I mean, it's a lovely image.
Mm.
My mother was of the sky, my father was of the earth, but I am of the universe. And you know what it's worth.
I'm lonely.
Eagle picks my eye, the worm, he licks my bones. Amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, blues.
Yeah, blues. So using mothers of the sky, the earth, the universe, so nature imagery.
Mm-hmm.
Words are flowing out like endless rain into a paper cup. Pools of sorrow, waves of joy.
Across the universe.
Yeah, just again, amazing imagery. Words are flowing out like endless rain into a paper cup. This is from his solo career. As again, I didn't really find too many because I had a Beatles lyrics book, so it was easy to find them. Don't need a gun to blow your mind. Don't need a gun to blow your mind.
It's whatever gets you through the night.
Very good. Mm. So blow your mind is like, yeah, amaze you, surprise you.
Yeah.
One you mentioned earlier, no longer riding on the merry-go-round. I just had to let it go.
That's watching the wheels.
Yeah, so I think the merry-go-round here is the pop music business, right? Would you say? Like, he retired for 5 years.
Absolutely. That's what the song's all about, really. It's like him sort of like retiring from the music industry, even though lots of people don't understand his decision and everyone's like, oh, come on, don't you want to get back in the big time? And he's like, no, you don't understand. I'm just sitting here watching the wheels go around, watching shadows on the wall.
Love it.
Yeah.
This is actually the last one, so we've done it. You won't have to guess the song here, but Mother, You Had Me, But I Never Had You. And a very interesting double meaning of Mother, You Had Me, as in you gave birth to me, but I never had you.
Yeah, he never really had a relationship with her properly. That's from the song Mother. Plastic Ono Band.
Yeah, my favourite John Lennon album by miles.
Yeah. Well, Antony, it's time to wrap up here.
Can't we do another hour? Come on.
Well, maybe we can do another hour. We can do more at another time, perhaps. But I think for this particular session, it's time to call it quits here and call it a day. But this has been great. It's been really interesting. Thank you so much for talking to us all about John Lennon and the Beatles. And, you know, I'm very curious to see what the audience, you know, how the audience responds to this with their comments and things like that. But this is great. And keep up the good work with Glass Onion on John Lennon, the podcast, Film Gold, the film review podcast. And the third one is on
Life and Life Only.
Life and Life Only, the third podcast. So listeners will find links to those in the usual places. But yeah, this has been great. Again, thank you.
It's been lots of fun. Yeah, it's nice to put my English teaching chops and my John Lennon chops into action. Yeah, it's been great. Thanks for having me on the show, and I'm sure we'll do something in the future.
Yes.
Come on, Glass Onion, if you want. Is there anything you want to talk about?
Well, I don't know if I could really contribute that much to Glass Onion, considering the sort of level of expertise that you've had from your guests and the first-hand accounts, you know, the primary evidence that you've got on there. I mean, I'm a huge fan. I can ramble, but I don't know if I'm qualified to be on Glass Onion.
We'll pretend you're the son of a doorman at the Dakota. How about that? We'll come up with something.
Yeah, maybe.
No, open invitation. If there's any like documentary you want to review or album you want to review. It's weird, actually. He only made a few solo albums and I've barely covered any of them. It's weird. I'm a bit loath to go into that territory because I think what I'm suffering from at the moment a bit is Beatles opinion fatigue. And it's always fun, but someone will say, oh, that's a great song. And someone will say, no, I don't think it's a great song. And it's like, well, okay.
I find opinions to be a bit tiresome sometimes, or certainly disagreement. You know, what I like from my Beatles podcasts and stuff is insight and anecdotes. I like stories. And I also like new approaches. I just like new ways of looking at the whole thing, new perspectives and things like that. I always find that interesting. And first-hand accounts. Anyone who actually ever met the Beatles or even glimpsed them once, I want the full 2-hour story of it. Okay, well, great. Antony, thank you again. And, you know, keep in touch. I'll be listening to your podcast and come back onto the podcast at some point. Definitely.
Okay. Yeah, thanks a lot and all the best. Good luck with the podcast and everything else.
Cheers.
So there you have it, friends. Just a little outro before the episode ends. I had to leave that last bit in about Luke wondering whether he was going to get on Glass Onion or whether he should be on Glass Onion, because of course now he has been, even though it was actually his show. He was actually on previously. He contributed a question to the listener audio questions last year. Anyway, Luke, as I said in the last episode, is the first person to do the hat trick of Glass Onion, Film Gold and Life Only. So congratulations to him. I hope you enjoyed that episode and the tangents and audio clips. I cut a little bit of the English teaching because I actually got a message after the first show saying, oh, I enjoyed it, but yeah, I know how to speak English, mate. Even though I did say on the intro to the last episode that this was from Luke's English podcast. Anyway, there's a link to Luke's show in the show notes. I've also put links to all of our previous collaborations. So I've been on his show a couple of times and like I say, he's been on 3 of mine and we've done swap casts or we've used the audio in both of our shows. We're all going to help each other after all. Now, regarding some of the clips and some of the discussion there, if there are any Beatles fans who still haven't discovered the Ruttles or maybe don't want to because they think they're making fun of the lads, it really is absolute gold. I watched a bit of it recently and just fantastic. Both the film, All You Need Is Cash, but especially just the songs and the way they were constructed. Just fantastic. So just before I go, a couple of things. The next show, well, the next two shows are going to be, well, I think it's going to be a two-parter. and I've called it Two of Us, and I'm going to leave the rest with you to guess what that's all about. There's actually going to be two or three parts to the episodes. I really wanted to end the year with something special, and I haven't recorded all of it yet. I've recorded some of it, and it's shaping up to be pretty good, so that'd be a good end to the year. If you like the show, please subscribe, follow, share links with people, tell people about the show. And of course, if you'd like to make a donation, there's a PayPal link and a Buy Me a Coffee link in the show notes. And that's it. I will see you in about 2 weeks for the first of the last two-parter of the year of Glass Onion on John Lennon. Thanks a lot for listening, and take care. Goodbye.